Welcome. My name is Peter Schilling, and today I'm joined by documentary filmmaker David Fresina. David's latest film, Mile of Hope, the Dan Cummings story, will be shown at MassBay Community College's campus in Wellesley on Thursday, October 9th at 4 p.m. and at 6:30 p.m. as part of MassBay's Thursday Night Film Series. As many of you know, October is National Disabilities Month, and David's documentary tells the story of former MassBay student Dan Cummings, who suffered a spinal cord injury, was told he would never walk again or be able to take care of himself again, and who, against all odds and all advice, was determined to recover, take care of himself, and walk again on his own. Thank you, David, for being here today.
Well, it's great to be here. I love it.
All right. Well, David, how did you encounter Dan Cummings, and what about his story appealed to you?
It was a Sunday morning back in October of 2010. I was driving to work. It was early, about 6 a.m., and I heard, I just happened to have the radio on to a talk show. This person was being interviewed, and the story of this person was just started to really hold my attention. And he talked about being paralyzed and at a young age, and how it took him 10 years to learn how to walk again, and which he was doing. And then he was talking about this event that was coming up called the Mile Walk, that was part of the organization that he had started. And the whole thing just really drew me in, and I wanted to know more about this. So I jotted down his name, and then a few weeks later, I did some internet research on him. I emailed him and told him a little bit about who I was and what I was doing. And he invited me to his facility, which is in Canton, called Journey Forward. And when I walked in there, your first impression when you walk in there is you see a lot of gym equipment and workout equipment, and which isn't so unusual. You see some people working on the equipment, and that's still not unusual. But then you realize, wait a minute, these folks here are all in various stages of paralysis, and this facility is helping them.
Yeah.
So with that, and then just spending some time that day with Dan, we knew this story had to be told. And he was all for a documentary.
Have you always made documentaries, or do you make other types of films?
No, I always the films that I make are documentaries. I haven't delved into any features yet. My first film, I started filming that back in 2008. It was about a tragedy that happened in San Diego 30 years prior in 1978. A plane crashed in San Diego. 144 people perished on the plane. And I went back to the anniversary of that in 2008 to film people who were part of that accident,
sure.
People who went to who had to go to the crash site, first responders,
right.
People who worked for the airline, family members, anybody in the neighborhood. So I interviewed quite a few people out there to put this film together, and it turned out to be a really wonderful piece where you sort of see the evolution of people healing over the course of the film, where for 30 years they had no outlet to talk about this, and now because I'm out there filming and people are starting to talk about it, they were able to open up not only to me but to their spouse, to their friends, and start talking about this again. And it created this whole sense of healing in San Diego back then. It was really neat.
Well, that's interesting because the Dan Cummings story is also about healing. Mm-hmm. When you choose the subjects for your films, are you looking for situations where people have healed from a certain event?
Not necessarily. It does seem to be a common theme in my films. It's something that does interest me. I do like to see people overcoming their own odds and their own issues in life that could have had a negative impact. For the most part, I do tend to draw toward that type of subject.
Well, the Dan Cummings film which I watched this morning for the first time, is fascinating on many levels. Dan's determination is impressive, and he's inspired so many others to fight to overcome the effects of an injury. From the moment he awoke in a wheelchair, he was resolved to get out of that wheelchair and walk, despite the fact that doctors told him he would not walk. He could not walk. Even some of his family members felt that maybe Dan was living in a state of denial about his situation, which begs the question, where is the line between determined optimism and just denial of reality?
Right. Well, with Dan, there is no line.
Yeah.
Dan was not going to hear anybody tell him that he was not going to do something. That was Dan before the accident, and that's Dan even more so now. He will use anything negative like that, turn it into a positive, and turn it into fuel for his drive, his goals, his passion, and he will not let that slow him down.
Yeah, it's almost like Dan developed an attitude toward some of his doctors. The doctors who told him he would never walk again, the doctors who told his family that he would never walk again. He almost feels toward the doctors that, you know, how dare they say that about him to his family.
Right. And Dan was Darren is very offended by that. Because they did, as he says in the film,
they don't know me.
Yeah. They don't know who I am. Yeah. They don't know Dan Cummings. And when you do know Dan Cummings, you realize that how true that statement is. Dan will just not allow that to happen to himself.
Yeah, his attitude is such a factor. Also a factor in his recovery is the role of the people around him. He had quite a support network, did he not?
He did. Obviously his family, his friends, people who didn't know him, they all rallied around him to help him get through this crisis that he was having. From people who had who volunteered to help stretch his legs and his arms and his hands in the morning, to people who had people who volunteered to drive him to different facilities for his ongoing rehabilitation. He just had this amazing support system that helped him through this.
Yeah. Now he started off. He ended up in Boston Medical Center.
Correct.
Then he was in Atlanta doing some physical therapy, and when he returned to Boston, he was shocked to discover that he felt the doctors were preparing him for life in a wheelchair, and he was preparing himself to get up and get out of that wheelchair. And he felt he had to go to California to find a facility that shared his belief that he could get out of his chair.
Right, and he was very upset and very discouraged about what he found when he came back to Boston. He just did not believe and was never going to believe that this was his life now. He wanted more, and his research led him to this facility in California, in Carlsbad, called Project Walk, and he did everything he could, made the arrangements to go out there against many of his family members didn't want him to go. His friends they couldn't believe that he was going to do this. He has this kid who still can't walk, who still can't really feed himself, is going to go 3,000 miles away to try to learn how to do all this, and away from his support network. So it was very frightening to many members of his family, but knowing Dan, obviously they said, okay, this is what you're going to do.
We can't stop you.
We'll help you. We'll do whatever we can. Good luck. So he went out there. 4 years later, he walked out the front door, and he has since just done some amazing things since then. He's just an incredible, incredible story.
And 4 years to relearn how to walk. And in 2010, he did walk 1 mile with a walker, but unassisted by any other person. Isn't that right?
Correct. Which is when I picked up his story, and when I heard him in the car driving to work, he was talking about this walk that was coming up to benefit his organization Journey Forward, where he was going to walk a mile. 10 years. It was nearly 10 years, not to the day, but it was 10 years since his accident, and he was determined to do this, and he did it. and there were thousands of people there watching him and cheering him on and sponsoring him, and it was just an incredible moment.
One thing that has come out of this is that, you know, Dan was dismayed to find a real lack of encouragement in the Boston area with regards to his hopes to get up and walk. And as you mentioned, he had to go to California to learn to do that in a facility that shared his beliefs. So he founded an organization here called Journey Forward. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, Journey Forward is a nonprofit organization. Dan uses the same or similar approach that what he learned out in California from Project Walk.
Yeah.
And he's in the five or six years he's had the organization. He has over 60 clients right now, maybe even more, and all various stages of paralysis. What his facility does, what his treatment does, is allows people to become mobile where they wouldn't normally have reached those goals. And what's kind of discouraging about this program is that the insurance companies don't pay for it. Mm. So it's all out-of-pocket expense for the patient.
Wow.
And Dan relies solely on donations and fundraisers and corporate sponsors to help his clients through this. And Dan's dream, of course, one day was that insurance companies will recognize this as a viable alternative, and it would just open up more.
Sure, it would.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, and obviously there's a need for this type of facility, probably all over the country.
Yes.
And all over the world, by extension. One thing that's so impressive about Dan, as I watch the film, is he never feels sorry for himself. His personality never changed. There's a story as part of the film where he talks about he's in a bar, he's in a wheelchair with his friends, and he sees a beautiful woman across the room, and he wheels over and says, you know, I think you're beautiful, how about a kiss?
Right, and that's a great story, from her perspective, she never saw the chair.
Right.
And that's the chair. The chair. When you're Dan, the chair or any device that he's using to make him walk or stand up just becomes invisible because Dan is so charismatic, so captivating. You're just drawn into his personality, and everything else doesn't matter.
That's quite amazing. Mm-hmm. And that woman is now his wife.
Now they're married. You know, a couple of years later. Yeah.
And Dan has no regrets about jumping off that boat that night into the lake and suffering the injury. It was an ill-advised leap, but it happened. And today he says, I don't regret it because I have a great life.
Right. Dan, after the accident, Dan realized that obviously this happened for a reason. As you can, in any person's life, you can look back at a tragedy or something negative and say, this happens for a reason. For Dan realized he was probably on the wrong path as a young guy, going the wrong way, doing the wrong things, and this accident sort of flipped the tables on Dan, and now he realized he has a different role in life, and it's helping people, helping his patients to journey forward, because if Dan didn't have this accident, his patients to journey forward wouldn't have a place to go.
Yeah, as he says, I'm on a mission to change the world.
Yeah.
He wants to help other people get up and move forward. Is there anything else about Dan you'd like us to know?
Just that Dan, when you meet Dan, you just are swept up in his aura, his personality. He has no judgment on you. He doesn't care who you are or where you come from. He just accepts everybody for who they are. And it's a great trait, and Dan's just a great guy, and if you're fortunate to meet him, you're all the better for it.
Well, we will have an opportunity to meet him on October 9th, but there's one great quote, and I'm sort of paraphrasing here, but basically in the book, in the film, he says, you know, whatever happened, happened. You can't go back and change things. You've got to just accept reality as it is today and try to move forward, and that's applicable to all of us.
Yeah, it is, and that's probably the biggest message from the film, is don't let a tragedy control your life. Don't let that define who you are. It's you have the ability to move on from that, and Dan is living proof of that.
And that is a powerful message in a very powerful film.
One of the first things I remember being in the hospital is advice that my brother Jimmy gave me. He said, do not look back at that night and ask yourself, why did I jump off that boat? He said, because there's nothing you can do about it. There's nothing you can do to change that moment. All I can do is make it better. And that's what I'm going to do. And that's what I went for.
And we wheeled his chair up the ramp, and he looked at me right in the eyes and said, I will walk someday.
When Dan came in, that was his goal, was I'm gonna walk again. You know, it wasn't I'm gonna take a step again. It was I am gonna walk again, and I want you to help me do that.
My eyes had a and that's in front though, Jack, you man, and Chris ran in. And they pulled me out of the water and saved my life.
I'm holding your right leg, but I need you to keep it out with me.
David Fresina, thank you very much for spending time with us today. David's film, Mile of Hope, the Dan Cummings story, will be shown as part of National Disabilities Month at MassBay Community College in Wellesley on October 9th. There will be two showings, one at 4 p.m. and one at 6:30. There will be a reception following each showing with an opportunity to meet both David and Dan Cummings. Both showings are open to the public with a suggested donation of $10 for non-MassBay students. 50% of all proceeds will support the rehabilitation of clients at Journey Forward, and the other 50% will support scholarship funds for MassBay students. Thank you again very much, David.
Thank you for having me. It was a lot of fun.
All right, and we hope to see many of you at MassBay on October 9th.